Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And for those that like peeking behind the curtain, this is my fourth episode recording in 4 days, and somehow I'm awake. And some of you can hear me speaking because my throat's usually dead if I do anything in a row twice. I am joined with the current reigning W3L Heavyweight Champion. He was last time in the 1.5 episode. We spoke to him as well in the last season. It is Taylor Bryden. Welcome to the show.
Woo.
So
We're
I'm calling this episode the next level. Like I'm a wee tagline. Thinking
yeah,
tier
no, I get it.
next
I
level.
worked some of the gimmick.
I like to just put it all together. It's there's a lot more work than people think when I'm making up these titles and doing this I was gonna say job. It's not a job, is it? How are you doing?
I'm good. It's good. But you're not giving yourself enough credit, Billy. Like that entire top 100 list that you did, that must have took hours to compile. So what was actually work for you?
Oh God, that was such a good idea when I put it out as an idea, thinking, oh yeah, I could do this. And then it took me like a week of trying to work Excel, which I don't know how to work anyway. And then I had to try and go through. So I thought, this year I've done it month at a time. So 1st of April, I'll do all of March's ones and put it in the spreadsheet. But I thought of that idea in November. So I had to do a year's worth of results tracking to get to do it. And you were number one.
Yes, I was. Thanks to the guys at Fair City Wrestling and mostly W3L, like Mike and Kev booking me very strongly for the entire year, which I was very grateful for.
Oh, I mean, I didn't put the numbers out, but yeah, your defense has really just put you quite far ahead of everyone else because you're defending your junior heavyweight title, your W3L title, like monthly. So it was a no-brainer towards the end. When I was doing the tabs, I was going, "Really? Is that right?" And I was looking at the defenses, like, "Yeah, every month you defended a title." So.
I think there was only no there, I did, there was 1 month that I tagged with Caleb Valhalla for a Fair City Wrestling, but I think I defended the title later that month as well.
Yeah, so
And
it was just,
yeah, so
but
pretty
then
much every month.
I mind when I was speaking to you in December for our one little 1.5 episode when we're backstage at W3L, and I was like trying not to tell you because I thought, oh, you better keep an eye on it. It's like, no, don't tell him yet because I want to be surprised on Christmas Day or Christmas Eve. I think I announced who was number one. I don't know what your reaction was to it. Were you like, ah, cool?
Well, you'd already kind of let slip that was in the top 10. So, like, as I said, it's not down to me, it's down to the people that actually book me and put me on shows. But it's nice to see that after what I considered my best year of in-ring work, for mostly, I think I really enjoyed about 80% of what I did last year, and I'm glad that what I thought I put out into the ring came across as that sort of number one spot, and I really appreciate it. Even though it was based on results rather than performance,
Was.
it sort of vindicated the hard work that I'd put in, or what I thought I'd put in last year.
I'm glad folk, yeah, it's literally like the PWI list. So for just so I didn't get caused I get accused of any bias. And then a month
No.
later I got accused of bias. So it was quite amazing how it worked out with poll
Was
rigging
that
and what have you.
what was that the Wrestle Zone Wank Fest, was it?
The Aberdeen Wankathon, that's what it was.
Aberdeen Wank Fest. Oh, that gave me a laugh.
I mean, I feel, that was the whole thing. But I got to hand out some of the trophy. You do have a trophy, but I will see you next time you come up for W3L, and you may have seen them online. You get a little trophy for
Woo!
winning an award.
I
So
did. I
yeah.
did. I did see everybody with their little trophies. So I'm glad that I get one of my own. That will go pride of joy in my cabinet in my conservatory.
So I've got it in front of me. So next time W3L is up in Elgin, I will send it to you or put it back. I'll give it to you. You will get it somehow.
Yeah,
But this year.
I think we're up twice this year in Elgin, as far as I'm aware. I th think Mike had said he booked Elgin twice this year, so. It'll be one of those times.
Looking forward to it. But yourself though. So last time we spoke properly, was episode 49. So it was April 2021. So it was March we recorded it, went out in April. And this year we're speaking of March, and it's probably going to go out in April. In 2050. So funny how things work out there.
That is indeed.
At that time, there was no shows. Nothing was happening because it was still pandemic. And then, of course, the wrestling return was about August, something like that, August, September.
It was my first show was August, but I think people had started running shows. Yeah, you know, it was the start of August, and I was at the end of August where my first show was in 2021.
The first time we'd have seen you since then would have been December 2021, of course, with. Right, so I spoke to Mayhem Brooks about this show, W3L Elgin, December 2021, and he had a great time because he lived in Elgin, so he didn't have that many travel issues. But this show was hampered by, it seemed to be everything. So this is one year return, probably one of the biggest trips you would have to make returning back to wrestling. How was that?
As any trip with Mike Musso is slightly disorganized, but... In his defence this time, somebody changed the code on the ring gets kept in a big blue container, and somebody changed the code to get into the yard where the big blue container is.
Right.
So, unfortunately, Mike didn't know the new code, so we couldn't get in to get the ring. So by the time we managed to get in to get the container, we were already 2 hours late for our setting off time. Then I think there was traffic on the way up. And then by the time we got there, we literally parked up and there was a queue outside the building. And we just had to try and load the ring in and get built as quickly as possible before the show could start. But thankfully, most of the people that were there actually understood that it was a big mistake. It was a one-off. And usually we do run Elgin fairly regularly. I think we've ran it for at least the last 7 years, maybe more.
It's been more than that because, first one I went to was 2012, Elgin. So I think it ran the year before that. So it's been good.
Yeah, 2011 then.
Yeah, so over 10 years. But yeah, it was. I mean, yeah, I was on my own anyway. When was it? So it was. Yeah, December 2021. So when I went there, I was already on fighting sleep. Was I? No. So I was born 2022. Oh, I'm always fighting sleep. But when I got there, we shifted into a little room on the side where the meet and greets usually are and that, and we just had to. The ring was late and we were late coming up. I was like, cool. But it was just so weird being on my own in that room, and it was just like all these kids playing and parents almost stone faced and disgruntled, and I'm sitting here going, I look weird here. I'm just on my own sitting in this rabble. But you know. Fair credits to you. The show happened. It was different because there was literally nothing there other than the ring, but still, it happened. So that must have been a nice welcome back to wrestling. Here it is.
Yeah, I'm glad that things have been sort of... I would love to say that they've been ironed out, but there's usually always something happens on a W3L show day that means that you're still setting up right to the wire before the doors open, but I don't know how, but I've never seen a man that can have the organisational skills of Mike Musso and still manage to, regardless of the situation, manage to pull out of his arse and put on a show. And as every time, and that's been, this is the 20-year anniversary of W3L's first show this year. So it's 20 years of him doing this and still manages to put it on. And everybody asks how he still manages to keep doing it, and it's because it keeps working. So that's why he does it.
By procrastination and all that, he gets there eventually.
He does.
But so go back to your first show at end of August. You said, what was it like getting back in the ring for the first time after a year and a half?
It was good. It was a bit different. It was for Respect Pro Wrestling. For Respect, I tagged with Craig Stevens against Bobby Roberts and Ewan O'Raw. So it was a bit different. It was a new venue that I'd never worked before, and a new promotion that I'd never again worked before. And it was just good being in front of the crowd again. I always enjoy being a bad guy a little bit more than I enjoy being a good guy. So being able to have my first match back as a heel, I thought this is great. This has set me up for the next year, because I thought I was coming back into Fair City Wrestling as a heel, and I wasn't sure what was happening in W3L, but I thought I was going to get put on the sort of heel side of things there as well. And as it turned out, that didn't happen, and I ended up spending all the last year as a babyface.
Just plugging away those defenses.
Yep.
But that's. I mean, you got to put your new body into effect as well, because of course, I mean, speaking to you before, and you had this big transformation and what have you. So you got to kind of give it a test run out, and was it all to standard, or are you like, I've missed something in my stamina here, or I've missed something?
No,
or...
no, my cardio was golden, absolutely golden. I'd been doing card workouts all through lockdown, all through the year, and I'd been keeping on top of my calisthenic stuff just to make sure that when wrestling did come back, that I had a gas tank that could go. But the thing is, not long after that, like I didn't really even get to be very lean for wrestling for very long, because by the time I'd done that show in August, I think I'd done maybe two or three more before the end of the year, I'd already decided that I was too small for wrestling. I'd got down to like 158 pounds, which is quite light. Like I'm 5'7". I was like maybe 8% body fat. And I thought, right, I need to get bigger. So I've spent from maybe, I think it was February 2022, just trying to get bigger and put on more size, put on more muscle. And I've just stayed in a calorie surplus for as long as I can, until I was starting to feel a little bit uncomfortable in my body, which has only been really in the last month that I've decided, right, it's time to cut down, put my calories down, and actually start trying to strip body fat down. I'm sitting at about 190 pounds just now. My lifts have went up massively since I was at 158 pounds. And I feel that once I cut down, I'm maybe going to be maybe 175 and pretty lean. And for a guy that's natural and like 5'7", I don't think I'm going to get any bigger than that at 34 years old. So I'll be quite happy if I could be at least sort of like in a ballpark of sort of 12% body fat, 175 pounds, I'll be happy. And then I'll be able to go on. Gas tank wise, even now, like I'm still currently trying to improve my game. Like I've dropped the card workouts, and I've been starting doing kind of Japanese dojo workouts. I done a couple of Chris Ridgway seminars, and I went down to his training seminar, and the stuff that he was doing there was even far and above what I'd been doing myself. And when I came back from that, I was like, right, that's the level that I need to go to. That's where I need to go next. So I've changed my training routine, and I've been trying to do as many squats as I can in a week, really pushing my chest workouts in terms of Hindu push-ups, reverse Hindus, and decline push-ups, just really trying to like work through muscular endurance and just trying to get that gas tank even bigger than it was before, so that this year coming, I can have an even bigger in-ring year, hopefully. Fingers crossed.
Absolutely. So we'll go back a little bit for when you came back to wrestling. So you came back end of August, and then a couple months later, title. You had your Reckless Intent UK Championship picking up there. And Reckless wasn't a promotion had you been in before the pandemic, or was it one of your kind of new places and suddenly you're the champion?
Yeah, I was just a new place. Like obviously Divers runs Reckless, and he'd said to me all the way through the pandemic, he'd obviously seen the work that I'd put in, and he'd always said that when shows are back, I'd love to have you on. So he did, and the first show that I was actually booked on was that Fatal 4-Way for the UK title, and I had no idea that I was getting the belt put on me, and I really appreciate that. It was like a nice sort of, I don't know, just acknowledgement of the work that I'd put in, and the belief that Kieran and Divers had that I could do something off note in Reckless. So yeah, that was good. I really appreciate that. Like first debut in a new promotion and title belt on the same night.
Bad, eh? Not bad. Trade. Yeah. And that really, like you're saying, they put faith in you because of the they saw the work that you done. But yeah, it must have been a yeah, it was fulfilling that you just went, right, I've done all this work and now I've got a title to prove it that I've earned, or at least that the guys, the promoters trust me with as well. Yeah. So it must be just it was all worth it. All the no fun meals that you had, worth it, because you got a bit of gold around your waist.
Yeah, it did. And that's what it's about. I just even though title belts to some people don't mean very much, it's still, like, in certain promotions, it's faith that a promoter's got that you could do a job that they're looking for, and I really appreciate that faith.
So from that point, of course, then February rolled round, Fair City Wrestling. So we're in February 2022. Fair City Wrestling became junior heavyweight champion against Ken Caden. A match that I think they've put up online. I'm sure I've seen it. Must have been on one of their full shows. So
yeah, I think it is.
So that must be another. You've got two belts. Your Taylor two belts. I don't know if you ran with that particular hashtag, but so you became.
I did not.
You became a two title holder, but I was sure I remember watching it. So it was a really great match from what I remember. But again, yourself and King Caden, was that now tick off, just making sure that you're still fulfilling the hard work you've done, and what was it like just winning an hour title?
Again, it's the same as what I said for Reckless. Like, Kev had seen the work that I'd put in over lockdown, and he knew that I could do a job. What he was looking for, he wanted the junior heavyweight title to be a work rate belt that he could put guys out in 20, 25, 30 minute matches and have the matches be okay and good to some instances, I suppose. And he wanted to try and build that sort of work rate belt, and it was really nice that he actually thought that I could be the person that could make that belt what he wanted it to be. And I think I did a good job, like a fairly good job anyway, of being able to put on matches that Kev was happy with and that, for the most part, I was happy with.
You were saying that you came back and, even though you were a heel for respect, you're kind of put into the pigeonhole of babyface elsewhere. But when I was finding watching your matches, though, there was always a little bit of this extra aggression. Was that a conscious thought that you're kind of like, I'm a babyface, but I'm still a wrestler. I'm still fighting to win. Was there any thought into that kind of aggressive side that you were maybe just teasing a little bit?
It's not even any thought. It's just more who I am as a person. It's just it works. I've tried being a happy, clappy babyface, and I'm just not that person. I'm not bubbly or effervescent enough to pull off the sort of, I'm not going to say it because loads of people do it really well, so I don't mean it as any disrespect, but a cheesy baby face. I was just going to go out and be myself and hopefully get cheered. If I didn't get cheered, I would try and make them cheer me. But a lot of the times, I didn't really matter too much in FCW because a lot of the matches that I wrestled were face-face. So there was always going to be naturally somebody that they were going to be attracted to more. And I thought, if I'm wrestling a guy like Spike Tierney, who does a lot of flaps and has a lot of hometown advantage on me, if I tried to go out and be out babyface him, I'm not going to. So I might as well just do my own thing and be a little bit different and just take whatever plaudits that I get from the crowd. Because as long as they're reacting and they're reacting for what I'm wanting them to react for, I feel that we're still doing the job.
Absolutely. I mean, there's guys that, I mean, opponent that you had, one of the like showcase shows that Dundee Academy of Pro Wrestling had, was Zach Dynamite. He's kind of got that same thing. He can be a good guy in places, but the act doesn't change. It depends on who the opponent is, really. But they can still tweak the audience reaction when they need to. So what was it like now getting, you're back from pandemic, you've now getting booked other places, you now got this plethora of new wrestlers to face, or at least wrestlers you've seen that you now get to face. Was it, I don't know if you had any input on maybe your opponents for FCW for the junior heavyweight title, but was there people out there you're like, oh, I can't, now they're in FCW, I can't wait to get a hold of them?
At that time, like, it was just basically whoever Kev wanted to put me against. He had like sort of a card of guys that he wanted to to have me booked against and defend the belt against, which was I done Zach Dynamite and Tom Atlas at a showcase show. I've did a couple way Spike. There was only like really one occasion where he let me sort of have some input. There was one month that he didn't have anybody in particular, so I got a chance to put forward somebody that I really wanted to work with, which was Robert Balfour, because I've known Robbie for a long time, and it's something that I really wanted to do, was to be able to wrestle him on an actual show. The match wasn't quite what I wanted it to be, but it's mostly my fault. Like, I wanted to make it a sort of grudge match because that's how we'd built it. And really, I think it would have been better if we'd just done like a standard sort of wrestling match with a normal wrestling build. But you live and you learn, and that's just one regret. But I'm hoping down the road that I can get another chance to step into the ring with them and actually put on something that I could be a little bit more proud of.
Yeah, I've been spotting some of your matches. Of course, some of the matches are on FCW Empire. One I watched, which I was blown away by, was yourself and Emerson Jane, which was just phenomenal. It was a great match between the two. Of course, anyone who knows me knows I'm a big fan of Emerson anyway. But to see you have this match, it was just incredible. And I like that it wasn't a male versus female match. It was a wrestler versus a wrestler match. I don't know if that becomes into your conscious at all, or if you just treat opponent as an opponent. You don't really think of that kind of outside possibilities of intergender or anything like that.
I mean, I suppose you could in some instances, but with like Emerson Jane, because of how talented she is and how physical she is as a person, you don't really need to acknowledge too much the gender, not in the dynamic between me and her anyway. The crowd certainly picked on that. Like, there was points that I knew as soon as I went out, as soon as I did anything, they were going to turn on me straight away, because it's just a natural reaction. People see a man fighting a woman, and they're going to side with the woman straight away. So I anticipated that reaction anyway. But in terms of the way that we actually went out and structured things, that wasn't in the forefront of your thinking at all. Like, the only thing we actually had any thought about was I was obviously going to be a little bit stronger than Emerson, because I am, like, just how it is. But in terms of how we were going to work, she's one of the best, not one of the best females in the UK. I believe that she's probably one of the best wrestlers in the UK. If you look at her body of work, it's fantastic. The absolute dedication to her craft that she puts in, she's just one of the best. And I wanted to have a match that I could be really proud of and walk away from and hopefully not pick apart, which I did anyway. But at the time, afterwards, I was really, really happy with how it turned out, and I was happy that the people that watched it backstage also liked it as well. So I was happy with it. There's two matches that I've been really happy with this year, and it was Stuart Lyons, like wrestling Johnny Lyons and wrestling Emerson Jane. They were my two favourite matches that I had this year. Well, last year, sorry.
I was about to ask if there is a match that you've watched and went, yes, that's happy with that. There's never a match you're happy with. No, never.
Like, you come back after a match and you think, yeah, that went really well. Like, you listen to the crowd, like, it went well. They popped for everything you wanted them to. They felt they came along in that ride of emotions with you. And I thought, I think that was great. And then you watch it back and you go, why did I get up so slow from that? Why did I do this? Why was I not more vocal here? Why didn't I do this? And I suppose, like, it's just part of being a perfectionist. If you're like, you're never going to be happy with anything that you do. And that was watching that Emerson Jane match back. As much as I did enjoy it, there's bits I was like slapping myself in the face, because I just thought I could have done something better there, or I could have made more of this. I would have to actually sit down and watch to give you any specifics, but I just know that after it and watching it back, that's what I thought. And that's what I think about all my matches. Like, nothing's perfect. Nobody's perfect except Kenny Omega. So, like, there's nothing that I watch back on my own and think that it was amazing. There's bits that were good. There's bits that needed work. And it's something that I'm always going to look at my own stuff to try and work on it and try and get better so that I can at least have less of those instances where I slap my head.
I've realised very quickly, because I piloted a season at a podcast thing called Behind the Match, and I would get a wrestler on and we would watch a match and they would go through it. And it was with Scotty Swift, and it was a match against Super Executioner. So I was thinking, this is be a bit of fun. That means we can have a joke and laugh a joke about it. But he sat there and just picked apart bits that he didn't like. And I was like, yeah, this series is not going to go well because wrestlers don't enjoy watching their own matches. So no. I will scrap that idea from my idea sheet here. But yeah, so it's just fascinating because I can watch a match and go, that was perfect if I'm in the moment and watching it. But you're right, even as a critical brain, I can watch back the match on YouTube and go, there's something that could be done. I don't know what, but something could have happened there that was better or what have you. So that's why I've stopped doing reviews of matches I watch on YouTube, because they're no fun to review them. It's more fun to watch and do your emotions afterwards and how you feel and all that kind of stuff, because at the end of the day, that's what the best bit about wrestling is, as a fan, is the emotions.
That authentic sort of feeling, like when you can come away from a match that you've just watched live and think, wow, like I really enjoyed that, like put apart all critical thinking, like the ride that you've been taking on has obviously done something that's made you think, that was great, I really enjoyed it. And yeah, it's just wrestlers being wrestlers and wanting to be better, like that's comparison to the thief of joy. And when you're always comparing yourself to other people or what other people do, you end up finding that you don't get miserable, but you do get to a stage where you're thinking, man, I just wish that I was better. And that's just where I'm at, just trying to train, trying to get better, trying to do as much as I can to eliminate those head slap moments.
Of course, I mean, like you said before recording, you're going down to Manchester to do a seminar with Chris Ridgeway as well, so you're always finding ways now to excel, or at least tweak or improve a bit that you think that needs to be improved. So a guy, Chris Ridgeway, what kind of draws you to him? Is it his style or just because of his experience? What's your kind of thought with going down to Manchester to see him?
I just like how he works. Like I really enjoy that sort of hold for hold catch style wrestling. I just think it's great. It's amazing to see people be able to flow from hold to hold and make it look legit, make it look like it hurts, and all make it make sense. And I just think he's one of the guys that does it really well. It was Sammy had trained with him before last year. Yeah, last year. And she'd raved about how good the session was. So we got a group of guys down to Manchester to see him. And it was, I think it was me, Judas Gray, Ronan King, JJ Lee from Reckless Intent, and Emerson Jane. And we all went down together. And so when I turned up, and it was a 7-hour session. So we started at 2, and we were scheduled to finish at 9. And when he started writing up the warm-up, it was 1,000 squats, 200 jump squats, 300 decline push-ups, 150 reverse Hindu push-ups, 150 Hindu push-ups, 10 as many reps as possible pull-ups, and like an ab circuit thing that was like 5 sets as many crunches, side crunches, and dragon flags that you could do. And when I seen that, I thought, wow, this is, like, I'm used to doing like maybe 500 reps of calisthenic stuff minimum, and then I'm already going to be beating that and just the squats. And I thought, if that's the level you need to go to have your engine big enough to be able to go for a long period of time at high quality, that's what I need to do. So when we came back from Ridgeway's, every week I've been doing at least half that, like every session. So I've been doing at least 600 squats, 100 odd Hindus, 100 odd reverse Hindus, 5 arm wraps of pull-ups, 150 declines, just to try and just get to that next level. Obviously, when you're working a full-time job, it's hard to get the time to spend three and a half hours doing calisthenic work. But it's such an important aspect of wrestling that I'm just wanting to focus on that. And also with him, he does a lot of sort of hold for hold stuff, and it was just being able to do more of that and have somebody that's really experienced be able to guide you through doing different things and thinking. It's more a mindset thing, thinking about how catch wrestling can work in with the modern wrestling style. So that's what drew me to him. And that's what drew me to Sammy as well. Like, she's very much a catch wrestler and does things in a certain style, and I love that style. I think Zach Dynamite's the same. He's got a very specific style that he works, and I think all three of us are quite similar in terms of how we work and how we think about wrestling. So yeah, that's basically it. We all just want to be better at catch wrestling.
I think when you went through that list there, I think by the third thing you mentioned, my knees were sore. And I don't know how, just the thought of doing all those things, and then my back started hurting when you got to about the sixth thing. And and just to think in that car itself, I mean, back in ye olde day, the thought of all those students that are primarily trained at different schools, all in one car, going down to a seminar down in England, it wouldn't have happened all that time ago, because of course you've got Ronan. We love Ronan. I think he's incredible. He's ridiculously incredible for 19, but he's coming up from the Northeast. They've got Judas versus Joe Henry School, and then yep. Of course you've got some veterans in there as well. And JJ, she was Reckless Intent. So it's just in all those different experiences from all corners of the country, and you're all traveling down to go and face Chris Ridgway and train with Chris Ridgway. So.
Yeah.
It's nice. I like this kind of friendly, in general, friendly world of wrestling that's been created. Of course, there's the wrong'uns, but they're in a weak corner now. They stay in a little corner. They can do their thing somehow unimpeded. But generally, we've got a nice half of the country that's really nice, and everyone likes each other for the most part as well.
Yeah, I think I got with most people, like, and wrestling anyway, but I'm really drawn to people that have got the same sort of mindset as me, like, and that want to go out and try and keep improving and keep getting better. But then, even saying that, there's so many people in so many schools that are doing that. Like, if you look at, like, Andy's school, for example, like, some of the talent that he's got at his school are just brilliant. Brilliant people, but also brilliant wrestlers. Like, people that are really trying their hardest to get good. And I mean, look at Daisy Jenkins. Like, she's kind of everywhere at the moment, and that's a culmination of years of hard work and, like, being a great standard that people want to use her, because she's just a great wee worker, I think, and will only get better. Like, the amount of people that she's going to be working this year alone, she's going to be a completely different wrestler by the end of 2023.
That's it. I was going to say, Andy, when I was speaking to Andy, he was saying that because she started later, she's just all in, because she's only got maybe a couple of years of doing this before her body goes no. So she's only got a couple of years to do this, maybe 5-10 if she's possibly lucky. So she's got to get all in now, and she's just went all in on the training, and she's it's paying off, because she's different to most wrestlers you see in the country as well, because she's got a bit of a lucha style about her. And she's just, she's ace.
Yeah, she's ace. There's no denying that at all. She's really good. Really good. And, like, the amount of work that she puts in, like, a lot of Andy's guys put in a lot of hard work. There's some really great guys there. But I think that's all over. Like, you look at the people that sort of WrestleZone are sort of bringing out as well. Like, you were speaking about Ronan. Like, I think he's fabulous. I think he's a really good worker. And he'll only get better. He's only 19. Mm-hmm. He's tall. He's athletic. He's got a good look. He's got a great gimmick. I mean, it's kind of up to him what he wants his potential to be. He could go out and do whatever he wants with the sort of attitude that he's got toward wrestling.
Absolutely, and he's very receptive. I mean, I don't want to totally destroy his old character here, but when you can message him and. Like, not that I give him ideas, but like round about Christmas, I went 4 words, the Ronin King speech. And he was just like, yes. And that was so, but he's very good at just, he's taking in lots of information from a lot of people, even like people like myself who never done it, but I've got ideas. So at least present it to them, and he'll go, cool, that's an idea. And he might do it, he might not, I don't care. But I like that he just takes it in, and he's not, he doesn't just brush off anything. It all part builds part of the puzzle, I suppose.
Yeah, definitely.
But we won't speak about all the other wrestlers because this is your interview. This is about you, in general. So I don't want to start listening and going, oh, they're ace as well, aren't they? So I'll just, I don't know why I'm using the word ace. I never use it any other time in my life, and I've started using it in this particular chat. Of course, W3L being your home promotion, the promotion that you've first spent the majority of your wrestling career at, you've finally won the heavyweight championship in September 2022 against Luke King Sharp at the main event at Resolution. That we've already talked about, you know, getting belts is cool, being trusted, but that one must have been, that must have been the most special one, though.
I mean, all belts are the same to me. Like it's more what Mike's put into me, like trusting me to actually go on and represent it at the top of the card, I suppose. But it is nice. It's something that I never thought I would do. I always thought I would sort of lie in the sort of mid-card in W3L and just do my thing, just be a really good little opener wrestler or somebody that does first half main. I never ever seen. I know that you shouldn't think of yourself like that, but I didn't see myself as a guy that would end up closing shows on a regular basis. So it's cool. It's good that I get a chance to main event pretty much every W3L show that I'm on now, and it's good that Mike's putting me on with guys that that help me elevate my game and actually accentuate the positives that I've got, like helps me like wrestle that style that I want to wrestle, because they also wrestle that style, like wrestling Gaia Hawks last time we were up in Edinburgh, in Elgin, sorry. Like, I really enjoyed working him because we wrestled quite similar styles, so we were able to put what we did together fairly easily, and I think it come off okay, like, and be a little bit different to everything else that was on the card that night.
That was what I was about to ask you, because that is in my notes, because of course I only get to see you wrestle like twice a year when you come up here, well, live anyway. And that match with Gaia Hawks especially was, I think I may have put it in my review, it was so different from the rest of the show. It felt like it was the main event because it felt like the main event. Because it was totally different. And Guy Hawks was just incredible. And to see you two just kind of keep up with each other. And even though there was a little bit of clash, because say you're more of a catch guy, you want to kind of grab a body part, and he was a high flyer, but he had a little bit of that in there as well. More of a striker also. And I love it when these kind of style clashes meet, because generally, most of the time, it creates something quite spectacular to watch. But yeah, that match with Guy Hawks, it was great.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. That's another one of those matches that I enjoyed this year. He was such a charismatic young guy, and I think he's only 19 as well. Like, I think he's like a really young guy, and he was brilliant. Like, for somebody that's not been doing it a massive amount of time, like, he's really talented. But if you look at, like, if you follow him on social media, you'll see that he's just been wrestling non-stop in Japan recently. So, like, he's got a good pedigree for where he's from. Like, the opportunities outside of Scotland are massive, I guess. But yeah, I really enjoyed that match. I enjoyed putting it on, and I knew from looking at the rest of the card and watching the matches through the night that we were going to be something a little bit different than what everybody else was expecting. Like, Mike's usual family show style, he told me just to go out there and do one of my style matches, and I was really happy to be able to do that.
Yeah, and it was definitely worth it. So I don't know if anyone's got the W3L network. I think it must be on there. I don't think it was.
It's actually on YouTube
as well.
It's on the YouTube. Yeah,
I know what I'm watching later. I forgot it was on there, so I'll be going to go watch that. So we've got some questions then. I'm going to just go grab them off Instagram. Try to, because I'm very technologically advanced. So this is why I'm looking at my phone down here like I'm an old man. So it's just in the corner of my eye. Right, so not there. I hate technology. There they are. Right, okay. So we've got a bunch of questions in from Instagram. This is through the Instagram stories, so you wouldn't have seen these questions. So the first one is, we'll start with Judas Gray. It seems like he has not asked DMG for anyone that's going to be disappointed, because I'm not going through DMG again. He's just asked, want a scrap?
Well, yes, I do. Yeah, that'd be great. That's one. He's one of the people that are on my list for this year that I would like to work in some capacity. Because as I say, we've done training seminars together. We've trained together in different seminars and different like sessions, and we've done little bits and bobs. But I would really like to see if that chemistry translates to doing a match in front of a live crowd. He's such an enigma. I think he's just got such a unique charisma to him that. That some guys just don't have. You've either got that charisma or you don't have it, and he's got that charisma. He's just got a great style, and I would love to actually work him. So yes, I would love to scrap.
He's also added, since I sadly can't make Tuesday, do an extra 100 squats for me. Kiss, kiss.
I'll add those extra 100 squats in later this week. Yes, I will do that.
But no, you're right, though. I mean, we're back to speaking about other wrestlers, aren't you? But yeah, Judy's great. It's just, yeah, I think I've maybe seen one match of his, but when I've spoken to him for the podcast, he's just this kind of just chilled, cool guy. And like, there's something about this. His head's going to explode when I say this, because his ego is going to just max out. But there's very much a Jeff Hardy vibe about him. And that's.
Yeah, I think that's I think that's very intentional.
But it's going to say that'll be the bit eclipse, the Jeff Hardy vibe about Judas Grey. But no, wrestling's great right now. That's just been, like, there's so many great characters and wrestlers that are about, that there's just so many that you go, who's your favourite? And you're like, no, but like a list of 20 here to start off with. Yeah. And then
loads of great guys just now that are coming through.
So other questions here. We've got Pete Muhammad, of course, from Wrestle Talk Muhammad. A big fan favourite here. Right, so he's asked, no doubt Taylor is in magnificent shape. What a transformation it's been. Was there any moments that he nearly gave up with getting into the shape he has?
No. Like, I was just on a mission. And once, the thing that really affects me is the unknown. When something's unknown, I will procrastinate. Once I've got a clear goal in my mind and a clear goal of how to get there, there'll be nothing that stops me. But it's the, because for years, like, I didn't know how macros and calories or anything worked, really. Like, you thought you were eating well. Like, back in 2012, when I was really hitting the gym, and I got disheartened back then because I thought I was eating well, and I was like, why am I not getting bigger? Why am I not putting on any muscle? And it was because I wasn't eating enough protein. But until somebody explains that to you and you've got somebody that can sort of keep you in check, you don't really understand. And because I didn't understand before, I would just give up. And then once it was all explained to me, I was able to just keep going and keep pushing through. And then I got to that 8% body fat, 158 pounds. I was shredded, had abs, and I was like, great, I'm now too small to be a wrestler. And then that's when I was like, right, I need to get bigger. So it's been hard. That's been the hardest bit, if you want, recently, is realizing that I'm eating in a surplus. I'm trying to gain weight so that hopefully when I cut down, I can be bigger than I was before. And I suppose because you have to look at yourself in the mirror, you have to still put on spandex when you're not feeling amazing, you're not feeling like you're very lean. It can be a bit disheartening, but it's just trying to get through it and realise that it's like a means to an end. You're trying to get bigger so that at the end you do look better. So I'm hoping that in the next sort of 8 weeks, I'm hoping that by the time that I wrestle Doug Williams on the 1st of May in Gala Shields, that I'm pretty shredded again, and because I'm being really strict. Like, I'm down low with my calories, my protein's still high, my steps, I'm still doing between 10 and 15,000 steps daily. I'm still working out 5 days a week. I'm doing all my calisthenic stuff. Pardon me. So I'm hoping that by the time it comes round to that sort of 1st of May, that I'm going to be looking pretty spick. But realistically, it's probably going to take a couple of weeks after that. But I'm going to try my darndest that by the 1st of May, I'm going to be looking good.
So that's a rematch there with Doug Williams. So that's with, well, two matches within 12 months with Doug. So are you, I would say, have you watched back your first match with him? Obviously picked all the holes in it that possibly you can, and this is kind of like your, I don't know, mini redemption. Anything that you thought you didn't do well in your first match with them, you're going to try and make sure that they're tightened up in this second one.
Yeah, well, pretty much, like, but I don't know if this is what's going to happen. But ideally, as long as I'm still champion by the 1st of May, I'll be wrestling Doug, and Gala Shields. And if I do wrestle Doug and Gala Shields, I'm hoping to do it under pure rules, because again, I love catch wrestling. I'm a massive fan of the pure rules matches from early 2000s Ring of Honor. Doug Williams was the second ever pure rules champion. And if I'm going to get any sort of redemption, I would love to be able to get redemption in a match type that he's, dare I say, synonymous with. So that beating him would actually feel like a proper redemption. So that's the plan, and that'll give me a chance to redeem myself for anything that I felt that I didn't enjoy the first time round.
Pure Rules is starting to creep into Scotland now. It seems to be Wrestle Carnival, of course. They brought in a Pure Rules Championship, which I think Chris Ridgway currently holds. So, of course, he came up for Discovery Wrestling, had that
he is the champion,
match. He had that match with Ian Skinner at Discovery. So it seems to be coming up north here, creeping in. And I know that there's a lot of wrestlers that I've spoken to that are a big fan of that kind of style. I've seen a couple of pure. It's not. I quite like a big sports entertainment-y thing, but I know that what I'm seeing is art. I just sometimes I don't appreciate it fully, but I know that what I'm watching is good. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's not your favorite. Like as getting like a flavored coffee and getting a vanilla one when really you want a hazelnut. But vanilla's okay. It's just no hazelnut.
But when they're done well, I know they're done well, you know. So when I was seeing Ian versus Chris Ridgway, I was like, I know this is a good match. I know it's not my style, but I know this is good, you know. So it's just one of those odd things. But you know, if everyone liked the same kind of wrestling, it would be very boring.
Yeah, well, you don't have any of the sort of comedy wrestling that you get, or the death match wrestling. It would just be two men in tights rolling around with each other.
We would never have the Bulgarian Baker.
Exactly. There'll be no bread in Scotland.
Jeez. Brexit may not be. I wish I actually kept their actual name because I just screenshot the picture. Got the mini underscore machine AM underscore FPWA asking, what's your favourite video game? Take a left turn here.
Favourite video game. I am going to say, this actually changed. It used to be Majora's Mask for the N64, and for a lot of years I held on to that because it is one of my favourite games. But I recently played Persona 5, and specifically Persona 5 Royal. It is just perfection. It's turn-based battling at its best, storytelling at its best, and the music is so good. Like, it's kind of like, who would have thought that acid jazz would be such an amazing genre to base an RPG around. But here we are in 2023, and Persona 5 Royal is still the best like turn-based RPG I've ever played. It's just fantastic.
I need to get into these games, because I remember ages ago I got a PlayStation Vita, and I put a tweet out just going, right, what game should I get for this? And Ken Caden was like minutes later just going, Persona 5. That was like his
for PSV Vita, did you say?
Yeah.
The Vita.
Yeah.
That'd be Persona 4. Persona 4 was as good as well. I also have that, but Persona 5 is like the definitive like Persona game. It's just fabulous. Like the way that the entire game structured is just fantastic.
I'll eventually get there. By the time Persona 10 comes out, I'm sure I'll be able to play it.
One day.
One day. I think last time I bought a game last week, but a Jedi Fallen Order, because it was like a fiver on PlayStation Store. I think I've played 20 minutes of it. Because that's just life now.
And you'll pick it up in 6 months' time and play another 5 minutes in it and then forget how the controls work.
Absolutely. That's it. The boy was asleep. I was like, I can sneak in a wee bit of a game here. Got my lightsaber on and he woke up. I was like, oh, Well, lightsaber, we're going away. That's it. Once it's gone. What else have I got on Instagram? I've got last one is from Reverend J. Campbell. Of course, he's a connoisseur of Fair City Wrestling.
He is.
Best wrestler in Scotland at the moment.
I mean, I appreciate that sentiment, and I'm glad that he thinks that. I think I'm a long way off it, but I'm always striving to try and be the best wrestler in Scotland. Will I get there? Probably not. But am I going to keep trying? I will definitely try.
If there was someone that you think that who'd be your pick though? Then if you're not thinking you're the best wrestler, or you're at least aiming to be there, who do you think's up there?
Define best wrestler in Scotland.
That's the next thing. Yes.
Because if you're on about the best wrestler in Scotland, the best wrestler in Scotland's Grado, because he's a genuine draw.
Yep.
He is a cross genre like star. Like, he's got television shows. He does his own panto promotion that he runs at Christmas, the panto wrestling show that he does. He's got like so many feathers to his cap. So if you're talking about who's the best draw in Scotland, it's still Grado, and he would be classed as the best wrestler. If you're talking about like somebody that's actually technically the best wrestler in Scotland, I mean, it's hard to look past people like Leighton Buzzard. I mean, look at what he's doing. He's booked all over the world just now. Emerson Jane, because she's just such a fantastic worker and works so hard to be the best. And yeah, that's kind of. Oh, and Jack Morris.
I was waiting for a breath there. I was thinking Jack Morris.
How can you say that? If you're not saying Grado, you would have to say Jack, because what he's just went on and done is just something that nobody's ever done. There's never been a Scotsman in the position that he's in and know pro wrestling. And that's an amazing achievement for what he's done. And if you're talking about like people that worked hard during lockdown, like I thought I worked hard, but the way that Jack came back looking after lockdown, he was just absolutely shredded to pieces. He was leaner, bigger. He was just everything that you'd want to be coming back into professional wrestling. Like, it's, I suppose with Jack, it wasn't a case of it was always a when is this guy going to do something. I would never have thought he'd been in Japan. I thought he would have got signed over in America, but I mean, Japan's an amazing step. Like, what he's doing just now, and it's only just the beginning as well.
I think was he on Great Muta's last show as well? So that's,
he was, yeah.
So that's always a piece of history there, although it's wrestling. Yeah. There's a likelihood there's going to be another last Great Muta show because it's wrestling. But, you know, yeah, for the moment, he's in the last one. And Joe Hendry as well, of course, a digital media champion for Impact.
Sorry, Joe Hendry, I didn't even think about that as well. Joe's done amazing. He's over Impact digital media champion. Getting genuinely over with the fans at Impact as well. So he's definitely in for a shout. It's just amazing to see so many guys doing so much in wrestling right now from Scotland. It's brilliant.
Yeah, especially when you see WWE and NXT and all that kind of stuff. It's just, I mentioned it in another podcast some recently. I don't know, I've done that many at the moment. But yeah, we're very lucky here that we're such a small country, but we've produced and still producing some absolute top quality wrestlers of different varieties. It's like nobody's coming out of here,
yeah,
just black pants, black boots, your wrestler. They come out with characters. They come out with, they're all these youngins now know how to use social media. So they're creating characters that people want to see once you get beat up,
yeah, or
once you see in action. It's just it's a good time. Like I said earlier, wrestling is ace right now.
Wrestling is ace right now.
When it comes to the social media side of things, that's still something you're kind of timid on, you're happy just more just letting your actions do the talking?
I'm getting better at social media. I'm just not amazing at it yet. I suppose it's the same with anything. Like, there's always reservations you've got about putting in your own stuff. Like, I'm not an amazing promo. I'm not a great talker. I'm still learning to be a better talker and be a better personality. Like, you're talking about, like, people have got gimmicks. I don't even think I really have a gimmick. Like, my gimmick is just that I'm a wrestler that wants to be a great wrestler. And how many of them are in the world? Hundreds and thousands, but myself, and I don't think I would get the best out of my work, because I'd always be thinking I have to do something different that's not my usual thing. And I know that, like, going out of your comfort zone is good, but even just doing some of the stuff I do take myself out of my comfort zone. I do a lot of different things and take a lot of different risks with my style. But I'm hoping that this year maybe I can be better. Like, I was better last year, and this year I need to be even better. So it's just a gradual thing. I'm not going to be a great promo overnight. I'm not going to be a great talker overnight. It just takes time, perseverance, and practice. And I suppose now, one of the sort of byproducts of being in these high profile positions in different companies is I'm getting the opportunity to speak more and to show more of my personality. So that's my goal this year, is to show more of my personality, more of my sports entertainment side of wrestling, rather than just my wrestling style of wrestling. But 2022 was a very wrestling focused year. I'm hoping this year could be still wrestling focused, but a little bit more sports entertainment in there as well.
Absolutely, fair enough. So of course we've got CCW coming to W3L, so Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. Have you had your eye on anyone particular in Copenhagen Championship Wrestling? So we've got guys like I've blanked. That is terrible of me as a host.
The Copenhagen Hangman.
There we go. We've got Nitro Green as well. Trying to think about
Nitro Green.
I'm
only really familiar with Nitro Green because we've wrestled on a couple of shows together. I've seen his work. I believe the month before I won the Junior Heavyweight Championship, he had been fighting against Ken Caden and Nathan North for an opportunity at that. So I've seen him work. So I kind of hoped I'd be able to work him, but I don't think he's over for some reason. I don't know for a fact. I've not seen the match graphics, but I spoke to Mike and just seen who was available. And he'd said if there's any preferences, but there's genuinely none. I'll wrestle whoever. It really doesn't bother me. I just hope that I can put something out there that I can be proud of and not slap my head too much at.
I was going to say, as soon as you said that, I was like, you won't. You're gonna dislike whatever you put out. Of what I've learned
but
here
I can
this hour.
Try, but the aim is always to try and like what I put out there. That's what my wife always says. She's like, why do you even wrestle? Do you sit and watch your matches and you hate every second of it? I'm like, yeah, but like, if somebody comes back and thinks that was the best match I have ever done, no one has ever done a better match than I have just done, then they're delusional. And they need to have a serious look into being mindful and self-reflecting and being able to look at their own performances. I'm not saying there is anybody that does that, but you always need to have that little bit of edge and come back and think, right, what did we do good? What can we be better at? Like, I really dislike the attitude when, like, if you do something and you go, that was all right. Was it all right then? If you're saying that was all right, you didn't want it to be all right. You want it to be good. You want it to be great. You want it to be perfect. Like, you don't want it to just be like a wee throwaway thing that you do. Nah, it's all right. All right doesn't cut it. All right's no good enough to me. And that's the way that I look at my matches. Somebody will watch a match back and look and say, yeah, that looked okay. I'm like, okay is not good enough. It's never good enough. Like, okay, you need to be great, or you need to try and be great at least. And I suppose that's always a sort of standard that I try and put my matches up against. Like, is it great? If it's not great, why is it not great? What can I do better to make it great?
I mean, the worst thing you could do is go onto a podcast and call yourself the greatest wrestler of all time. That would just be that possibly would be the best idea. But before we wrap up, I'm a little bit of a bitch this season, to be honest, but people have rubbed me the wrong way this particular season of the arc of podcasting, and I'm just letting it out one petty comment at a time. So we've got Suzanne asking a nice question, kind of also wrap up. I'm seeing the time here. I'm just asking, who's the one wrestler that you've never faced but you really want to?
One wrestler I've never faced. There's actually quite a lot, and like if I'm thinking back to people, there's quite a lot of guys that I would like to wrestle. Like I've never worked Ian Skinner. I would love chance to work against Ian. I think he's really talented. Kez Evans, I think he's brilliant. Really fantastic. But I'm going to say, because it's actually astounding that, I think 17 years for him, 18 years for me, we've never wrestled each other, is Andy Wilde. Like, oh, sorry, Andy Roberts.
That surprises me.
I've never worked him ever. I did a run-in in one of his matches once, but I've never actually wrestled him ever. I've done stuff in training with him at different points through the time, but I've never actually wrestled him on a show. So Andy Roberts, that I'm going to go out there and say that. I've never worked him. I've always wanted to work him. I really respect the sort of way that he wrestles. So yeah, Andy Roberts, that's who I'm going to say.
Perfect. Well, I think that's a nice way to round up then your intention. Hopefully, by the time this comes out, but by the time 2023 ends, you would have found your voice and also got your match with Andy Roberts. Fingers crossed.
But we can only bit strive and only bit hope. And as long as we're doing the right work, I'll eventually get there. How long it takes, nobody knows, but at least we can try.
Absolutely. So anything you want to plug before we go, your social media handles or anything like that? Or any other
I don't
matches.
Know my social media handles off the top of my head.
I will do it for you then.
Yeah, so, that'd be great. If you know them, that's amazing, because I don't know my own. They're all variations of Tier Zero in some way, shape or form.
They are. So I'll do Twitter because that's the one I've got in front of me. It's at tier_0 with the O is a zero at TB. So there you go. If you want to go on Twitter. But if you're finding this podcast, you've probably found it through social media. I would have tagged Taylor in it, so it'll be fine. But no, that's been nice. I'm glad we got this catch up, because like I said, we had 6 minutes last time we're backstage, so I'm glad that we got a proper catch up here, and I'm just looking forward to seeing you against Andy Roberts. In the meantime, I'm going to go check your match with Emerson Jane again and Doug Williams, so that's my evening sorted. But no, thanks
very much, Billy. I really appreciate you having me on.